A lovely little insight into some of the players, how they made it to this lovely occasion, the first ever Pokemon International Championships 2016 for the trading card game. Absolutely brilliant. From Guernsey to Philadelphia, plenty of stories, Pokemon bringing everyone together for such an amazing occasion. It's already been an amazing day one. The day two is still progressing, and we've got plenty more in store.
Yeah, lovely occasion, but, well, there's a city that has airports that are called London airports, and it still takes you 2 hours to get into the city. Oh, well, okay. Well, that's none of our business. This is Tord. You've gotten him to know last time. Yesterday he was on stream as well. He's packing his Yveltal deck with 4 Yveltal EX copies, so we are happy to see him back on stream. And I would like to confirm to you, the Houndoom is here. Joe, what can you tell us about this deck?
Well, the Houndoom deck is going to take a very different approach to the typical trading card game decks. Most players know the win condition for the Pokemon trading card game is taking 6 prize cards. However, the Houndoom Bunnelby Raticate deck that Martin Janouš is going to be playing is taking a different approach. It doesn't care about prize cards. It's going to try and win by decking your opponent out, meaning that they have no remaining prize cards in their decks before the time that they have taken their 6 prizes. So Martin's been playing this deck for the last regionals. He was able to make top 32 in Dortmund, so it's a deck that he's already made decent accomplishments with. Again, he's in day two with this deck, and really the deck tries to prey on other Pokemon cards that really need high energy attack costs, and wow, straight away Tord does, I'm sure with a sigh of relief, lead with his non-EX XY Yveltal with the Oblivion Wing attack. This is going to be a really crucial card, I think, in this matchup throughout the 3 games because it's able to recover energy cards. And Martin's whole strategy is going to be denying energy cards.
Exactly. How do you get to the point that your opponent does not have any cards left in his deck? Of course, until that time, he would be able to get a lot of attacks in unless he has no energy to attack with. So this is what Martin is trying to do. Get rid of cards in deck, get rid of energy in play. But with Tord having his Oblivion Wing Yveltal, it's going to be tough for Martin to get rid of all the basic energy. This is exactly why Tord is playing this Yveltal.
Yeah, and this Houndoom Bunnelby deck, it's a really interesting one because it feels to me like one of these decks where in early rounds you can quite comfortably take wins where oftentimes you don't even really consider yourself favored in the matchup because sometimes an opponent may not know how to play around the deck. Tord Reklev probably is a very experienced player. We know that he's been in the top tables for a while. He knows exactly what Martin's playing, I imagine, at this point. So he's going to be very conservative with his own bench size. We may not see him do anything for a large amount of turns during this game. He may simply be content to draw pass throughout many portions of it. So it's going to be interesting to see how Martin is able to overcome these sorts of obstacles that Tord is going to try and bring up. First of all, we see a Crushing Hammer. That, however, does get a Tails.
Well, we'll see a lot of flips today, especially in this matchup here. Now that Crushing Hammer has failed, he still has Team Flagrant to work with. There's an energy attachment to the Shaman and another Shaman. Well, he doesn't want to be the one decking out, but he needs to have access to a couple of cards. For example, Bunnelby or Houndoom EX to make sure that as long as the Yveltal is stuck in the active spot and can only deal 30 damage at a time, that he has something to discard cards out of Tord's deck. But unfortunately for him, he only has Shaman at this point.
And a couple cool entrances and inclusions that Martin has in here is this line of the 2-2 Raticate. Both pieces of this evolution line are very effective in a lot of matchups. The Rattata has the ability making tools, or it takes off the active Pokemon's tool. Oftentimes things like Floatstone, that's the only switch card that Tord has in his entire deck. So that's going to be something Martin is going to try and prey on if ever he's able to. Raticate has the attack, two attacks actually. One of them is for a single energy, which does 10 damage and gets rid of any energy attacks to your opponent's active Pokemon. And then it has the second attack, which deals 60 damage times the amount of special energy in the opponent's discard pile. So Tord has to be careful on a lot of fronts here, because oftentimes against mill decks, you're pretty content to simply set up one attacker that runs through the entire board. However, Martin has the option to attack back. And if ever Tord has a lot of double colorless energies in his discard pile, that's going to become a problem for him.
And that's also one of the reasons why Martin is able to advance here into day two. You can see here 9 wins, that even one more than Tord has, so no draws at all. So he's either going for the win or that it's going to lose. So this is Martin's approach. I personally like it a lot. You might not like it if you're his opponent, but it's very interesting. Very interesting deck and a very interesting strategy to get to those victories. So we're going to see if Tord is experienced to see or to know what Martin is going to try and throw at him and if he has the right answers.
It seems like he's happy enough to go for the Ultra Ball for the Trubbish. Something shutting off the Rattata is going to be important, I think, at times because the Floatstone is so important. So we do see Tord go for that Trubbish as quickly as possible. Using that Ultra Ball, not sure what else he has in his hand. It's oftentimes the case that you can simply draw pass turns against Martin's list simply because you don't want to play too many cards out yourself. We see the Fighting Fury Belt come down, and he does opt to use the Professor Sycamore. So instead, he doesn't actually want the Garbodor. He wants to get rid of the cards that he doesn't need and maybe try and put Martin under pressure here, because Martin has a lot of cards in his deck which are meant to stall and slow things down. That means he doesn't have quite the number of consistency cards that other deck lists do have. Martin, so far, he's only been able to get two Shaymany X's onto the board. So maybe Tord can simply rush him, take enough prizes to simply win the game before Martin's able to get going properly here.
Yeah, it's most likely not going to be the best start for Martin here. And usually if you're Martin, you're, funny enough, like to see your opponent playing Professor Sycamore. Not so much in the beginning, but later on when he's forced to go with a Professor Sycamore or with an N to draw into more cards because he just doesn't have the resources to work with. In this case, Tord was looking for an energy. Luckily for him, he found himself one and he's attaching it to the Oblivion Wing Yveltal using exactly that attack and recovering the energy that was just discarded and attach it to the Yveltal EX.
Yeah, it looks like Tord has a very, very promising hand. He has a few dark energies in there and he has supporters if ever he needs it. So he feels pretty comfortable at this point. Only 30 damage being pressured on Martin's Shaymany X right now. There's not too much going on in his hand other than a few basic energy, a couple of max potions which aren't too helpful just yet. There is a Crushing Hammer though, which of course could be handy. He does look to be eyeing up an Ultra Ball. Obviously, he can't draw many cards because both of his two Shaymany X's are currently on the field, but he could be looking to grab something like Houndoom to start applying pressure and starting to mill cards out of Tord's deck. This not only helps, you know, the mill approach in general, but oftentimes, because Martin's list has so many Crushing and Enhanced Hammers, people will try not to put down double colorless energies. So they're going to be remaining in the deck or the hand. Well, Houndoom's able to access the deck via the mill approach, so in a way as well, this is even an approach to try and increase his damage output here.
And what Martin likes to see now is if he retreats and attaches to the Houndoom, he would love to see some cards being discarded while he was attacking, but forget about that. It looks like he's using Sky Return to get rid of that Shaman from the board, use it later on to draw some cards. But having said that, if he's using Houndoom, what he would love to see is cards being discarded, something like Floatstone, some more energy going into the discard pile so that Tord cannot use it to retreat that Yveltal. That's why he's using Team Flare Grunt. He's limited to a damage output of 30 for now, unless he finds a Floatstone.
Yeah, I really like the Sky Return from Martin there. He doesn't feel too pressured. There's just the non-EX Yveltal currently in the active slot, so you're happy enough to bring up the Houndoom. So you may as well just bring up the Shaman to your hand so you can try and use it later. Tord is simply going to attach and use the Oblivion Wing. Again, he's setting up this Yveltal EX. He wants to be able to simply get a Yveltal EX to the size where it can simply run through everything. Martin has a lot of healing cards in his list. He's playing a full four count of max potion. You can see him now doing the maths with Evil Ball to see if he needs to stay out of range. And indeed, he does say that that 30 damage is relevant enough for me to heal out of. He's then going to use a VS Seeker to once again try and reuse that Team Flare Grunt. Straight away, you can see the approach that he's taking here to try and stop the opponent doing much. We see him draw into a lot of energy cards. I think that's one puzzle of time as well. But he does have Professor Sycamore for next turn. And straight away, we do see a Melting Horn, and that is a two huge cards right there.
Absolutely. The double colors would be one of the outs for Tord to retreat that Yveltal and start Evil Balling away. Not so much an option right now. I didn't see what he was drawing into, but he would have loved to get this double color, this for sure.
Yeah, the double colors in the discard now. Tord does not play anything like Special Charge, so that's going to be in there forever. And that means that the Raticate is currently doing 60 damage if ever Martin does want to start attacking for damage. It's always that sort of niggling feeling in the back of your head if you are Tord that that could just wipe out the one attacker that I've chosen to set up here.
That's just, yeah, this is how Martin's deck work. And just imagine Tord did not have this Oblivion Wing. Imagine this would be the Fright Knight Yveltal. Mm-hmm. What was Tord going to do right now? He would just lose energy after energy after energy. This way, he's at least able to keep the energy in play, but it's on the bench. So this time, Martin has to go with Professor Sycamore. No Versus Seeker for Flaregrunt anymore. So he's hoping for a Crushing Hammer Hatsy if he has access to it to make sure that he cannot retreat next turn.
I think Crushing Hammer is going to be a big deal, and also finding more backup Pokemon. You
here
saw him attach the energy to the Shaymany X
this
to maybe retreat. And there's a big heads from him there from the Crushing Hammer. Really good stuff. He might follow up with an Ultra Ball here, so he could potentially get maybe another Houndoom out. Alternatively, if he is feeling safe enough, he could simply go for the attack the Melting Horn from the Houndoom EX. We are first of all going to see the Super Rod helping out get three of those Fire Energies back straight away, and they're going to get shuffled back into the deck here. And yeah, it's an interesting start. Most people, we've seen a lot of Yveltals throughout both days already, and Tord is one of the rare few who is going to be playing the X and Y Yveltal with the Oblivion Wing, and right now you can see that that inclusion has been fully justified, and I'm sure he's happier than most to be playing against Martin Janouš, who are playing Yveltal, because oftentimes people have no answer at all to this sort of approach.
Here we go. This time, two cards that Tord likes to see discarded. He doesn't need them anyway. And now there's double colorless. Let's see what he's going to do now.
There's a double colorless energy, so he has to be careful. Even if he wants to grow aggressive, attached to retreat, then he's moving in once again to that Raticate, which we haven't seen any signs of the Rattata or Raticate just yet, but it's something that he has to be concerned about for the rest of the game. The Fighting Fury Belt is good for the maths right now, but oftentimes that will be going off the board regardless because of the Rattata, if ever Martin is able to find it. Tord does opt to attach the double colorless energy to the Yveltal in the active slot, so it's likely he's going to be retreating here, and he's going to start firing off some Evil Balls or even the Y-Cyclone, because Martin is so set on using lots of disruptive cards, even things like Lysander. He plays a 3-count in here to try and access heavy retreating Pokemon, so the Y-Cyclone would mean that there's really no point if Martin wants to go for a Lysander play, because then that Yveltal can go back into the active and start attacking again. So Tord's going to bring this guy up, and it's going to be interesting to see what attack he goes for here.
Yeah, he can pick up the knockout if he wants to with the Evil Ball, so I think he's going to go for it. And there we go, Houndoom is knocked out, and now Shaman becomes active with one energy attached to it, and we can see that Tord has been able to draw into a Shaman and a Professor Sycamore, I believe, from his prize cards.
That's not too bad. Martin has a few options here. He's eyeing up that Lysander. Like I was saying, the Y-Cyclone was a potential option for him. He's thinking about the maps once again. He can start counting the huge amount of energy that's got on there. He's also going to count Tord's hand. Of course, Delinquent is a card that Martin plays, so he has a lot of different disruptive options here. And it's going to be interesting which one we see him pick. He does go for that Ultra Ball. That early attachment to the Shaman may have looked fairly irrelevant, but in fact, it's going to be brilliant here, because if he wants to, he can Ultra Ball, find himself another Houndoom, and start getting even more mill going. It's going to be cool to see what he goes for here. You can see Rattata on the top of his deck. He's opting not to get that just yet. He is going to go for the Houndoom, it looks like. He's considering his options, though. He does have a few tricky decisions ahead, because currently that Yveltal EX has way too many energy to deal with. It's not a comfortable spot if you're Martin right now.
Yeah, I like the Houndoom play at this point, because if he has the option to play Lysander now for the Yveltal, he knows that two double colorless energy are discarded already. He doesn't know that one of them isn't a prize card, so for Tord, he needs to find a Floatstone or one of the double colorless. And at the same time, Martin knows that Tord is not going to be digging too deep into his deck, because that means that he would lose deck cards. And so here we go, there's an N and then Lysander. I doesn't like to see those. He would love to see a Floatstone. Instead, Tord is drawing into another N, and this is actually a card that he does not mind playing because he has so many cards in hand.
Absolutely, this N might well be coming down this turn. He's desperately having to look through his discard pile. It's something you always have to keep track of, not only the cards that I've played this game, but also the cards that have been milled from the Houndoom consecutively. So you can see he's already conscious of counting his deck. It's something you have to always be on the lookout for against a list like Martin's. He's looking at that Yveltal break that's stuck in his hand. It's one of those things where if you put it onto the board, it's one less card that goes back into the deck. And that's a good and bad reason to play the card right now. You want to use N maybe to access to energies. In fact, he's going to go for the Professor Sycamore here.
Whoa.
A very aggressive approach from Tord. I think he wants to really pressure the Houndoom as quickly as possible, because he knows that Martin doesn't have, he just has the one card hand right now for a start. And also, he knows that Houndoom can only deal with so much pressure. There'll be a point where that Yveltal EX could get too large and simply is unstoppable and takes the game from there.
Yeah, but Tord gets rewarded for this aggression here. He finds himself a Floatstone. This is what he needed, and also an energy, which is also what he needed, because that would mean that with this Max Elixir hit, he would be able to pick up the KO on the Houndoom again. He picks up the energy, attaches Floatstone going to the active Yveltal break, going to retreat, and at this point, Martin is not going to be able to Lysander his way around for any time soon.
This is absolutely huge. This Yveltal EX is pretty much unstoppable at this point. That's a really big Professor Sycamore. Tord realizing that you know what, I can win the game in two turns if he simply has no answer to this guy. And putting a Floatstone on the XY Yveltal pretty much means that Martin's outs are very limited. We know his only card in hand is a VS Seeker, so it's going to be really awkward for him.
Yeah, I think Todd checked his discard pile quite often. He thought, okay, I haven't seen any Floatstone yet, so my chances of getting a Floatstone out of the Sycamore are rather high. And if I hit it, and if I get energy, I can put on so much pressure that I can win in two turns. And he's exactly going with this strategy, gets rewarded, goes with the Evil Ball, and Houndoom goes down.
Absolutely. So just so many energy. There's been a lot of games on stream where there's been a Yveltal that's been simply unanswered, and this again is going to be one of those times. Tord is doing the maths, and he is simply going to go for the Evil Ball, taking two more prizes. He's just one EX knockout away from winning the game. And look at Martin. He doesn't have many options. I think just the VS Seeker. He may be considering scooping at this point. Martin's main approach is going to be trying to deck out the opponent, and oftentimes that's a long, arduous process. So he might have to try and buy himself some time and end up conceding the first game. He is, first of all, going to go for the Professor Sycamore. I do like this approach because there's no harm in seeing these top seven cards. There could be some way he can swing the game, maybe. So we are going to see. He's found himself at least an energy and a non-EX Pokemon, which he can put into the active. He does have Bunnelby in there, so he can put that down. But beyond that, not too many other things. The Fighting Fury Belt isn't too relevant right now. Everything is getting knocked out by an Evil Ball. As we saw, the Houndoom was getting one-hit KO'd, so the same would be the case for Shamans, even with Fighting Fury Belts. He may take it simply, but yeah, he has gone for the concede here. Save himself as much time as possible. There's no out left for him. Tord had completely set up his board perfectly. I think, really, going into the next game, one of the things that wasn't a factor was that Raticate line. I think it's a really big deal because it puts Tord on the back foot on two different counts. He has to be so careful about his double colors energy, but also there's that situation right there where a Fighting Fury Belted Yveltal EX isn't enough sometimes. If there's two Rattatas down, starting to evolve into the Raticates, then those attacks can really add up. And again, Crunch is an attack that gets rid of even more energy on top of your Team Flare Grunts and your Crushing Hammers.
We haven't seen any Rattata or Raticate during the last game, but with these few players left in the field, do you think Todd knows exactly what Martin here is playing?
I would be shocked if he did not know that there was a rogue Houndoom EX Raticate deck running around. And especially Martin Janouš, who has been known to play it in previous tournaments, so I'm pretty certain he'll know that there will be a Raticate line in there. But we also saw how well he navigated the matchup. I mentioned earlier on in the first game that good players know how to manage their board. They know how to ruin the outs for a deck that is full of disruption cards. He never played into a Delinquent. His hand was already always above three cards. He never really had any Lysander stall targets. And he, of course, had the crucial non-EX Yveltal, which he happened to lead with, which was absolutely brilliant as a starting point. And that just meant that all of the Crushing Hammers, the usual things that Martin would be doing so well, were just not as effective.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting to see, assuming that Tord would start with a Fright Knight Yveltal, for example. Then we have so many different factors to keep in mind. Then he would need double colorless to retreat. He could not recover any energy if it gets discarded. He couldn't use Floatstone without Garbodor being online, mm-hmm. but he would have to bench the Garbodor and invest another Floatstone in it or another attachment. So many, many factors coming in if Tord has not the luxury of starting with an Oblivion Yveltal. I don't want to wish it upon him, but it would be very interesting to see on how he would react if he did not have access to it in the first seven cards.
Yeah, it's going to be a completely different game, I think, from the first one. Just the perfect lead Pokemon, having plenty of dark energy he had access to. Just everything went really well for Tord there. And as you're saying, just one different lead Pokemon then becomes, for the rest of the game, potentially a stall target. So it can't have gone any worse for Martin the first game, which means it can only get better for him from here. And he also gets a nice Mulligan to start things off, so he'll be drawing one extra card before he starts his turn, so that's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, there's the Mulligan. Well, Tord is happy about the Mulligans, better than a Fright Knight Yveltal to start with in this case, or even a Trubbish. So he's shuffling his deck again. We can already see Martin's prize cards. Nothing special in there, a Crushing Hammer, Olympia, a Max Potion. Nothing to be really worried about if you're Martin.
Yeah, those prizes look absolutely fine by me. And he's got to be pretty nervous because normally, I've spoken to a few players, I've spoken to Martin, and I've also spoken to David Rudhoff, who's a notable European player who was playing the same deck yesterday. He had a respectable record with the deck, And he basically said that this tries to prey on decks like Yveltal, because so few of them actually play the XY version anymore. It just so happens that Tord is the one who does, and that's who Martin is having to play against right now.
That's very interesting. Well, he tried his best and tried to react to it. As we can see the Rattata, let's take a closer look at this Rattata real quick.
So Tord straight away has to read it himself just to make sure that he's fully aware of what that Rattata does. When it's put down as the starting Pokemon, of course, its ability does not activate. It's similar to something like a Shaymin EX, where you have to get the activation of the ability by playing it from your hand to your bench. So that's nothing to worry about, and its attack isn't much to worry about just yet either. However, this might be a game that's a little bit different, because straight away he's threatening Rattata, and that could change the mechanics of this game.
Yeah, we can already see that Tord has access to a Float Zone in hand, I think also an Ultra Ball, so he will be able to do something out of his first turn unless he gets End. And Martin is setting up with a Shaymin EX, getting himself a couple of more cards as he's done last game.
Yeah, it's really not a bad start for Tord. The Stardust Jirachi, of course, it's not going to be doing much here. Martin only plays basic fire energies, and obviously its damage output isn't great. But the best thing is that it's a single retreat cost Pokemon, and that saves him a lot of headache down the line, so it could have been worse for him. Interesting that we see Martin go for the Rattata straight away. Typically, I think this is a very helpful ability that could maybe trap a Trubbish in the active position. Something like that could be really big. But maybe Martin's just being a little bit conservative, worried that he could otherwise suffer losing the game. He chose not to put down his Shaymin EX. He was happy not to. He wanted to search it out just to have access to it. But of course, because Tord does play the Max Elixirs, he had to have more than one bench He had to have more than one Pokemon in play to, you know, survive. So it was an interesting line from him.
It's very interesting, especially if you're taught now. If you're playing an Yveltal EX deck, you usually have an idea on how your deck will succeed, and you know how to set up. Sometimes it differs from different opponents and different decks you're facing, but this is so different. This is so different from what you're usually doing. You have to think about every single card that you're playing. Is this really necessary? You have to watch your resources really carefully. Every single Professor Sycamore brings you closer to what your opponent is trying to achieve. So in this case, he's eyeing out a Professor Sycamore with Trainer's Mail. He's using an Ultra Ball, and let's see how many Pokemon he's actually going to look for. With the Ultra Ball, we know his prize cards. He has access to Oblivion Wing Yveltal, and I would be surprised if we would not be going for it very soon.
Yeah, the fact that he didn't take the Fighting Fury Belt from the Trainer's Mail probably means he might just be going for the EX. Alternatively, he could obviously still go for it. It's never a bad shout here, but the 40 HP on the Rattata seems very tempting to take an early prize, take the aggression. So, not sure about this. He does have the Max Elixir in hand, so even the EX could be tempting. The fact that there's only a one of the XY Yveltal may well tempt him into searching this one out first, because he still has a Professor Sycamore in the back where he has a higher chance of drawing into the EXs, which he plays four of course.
And there it is, still looking through his deck, just making sure he knows what the count is on the most important cards, even more important facing Martin's deck. He notices that all of the Float Stones are available. One of the double colorless is priced, however, and also one of his Trubbish, but he doesn't really care about that one in this matchup.
Yeah, absolutely. So Tord, I think he does have one basic dark in his hand, but he also has the Max Elixir. I think he's probably going to go for the Max Elixir play. He has the Float Stone, so he can guarantee an extra attachment as long as he can get the Max Elixir working, because then he can play the Professor Sycamore, discard the Dark, so his Oblivion Wing is already getting value. However, not so lucky, so it looks like he's probably going to commit his energy for the turn as an attachment onto the non-EX Yveltal here.
Yeah, he looked like he was about to ask the judges if he's allowed to attach the double colorless energy because he didn't find a darkness energy, but decided against it, shuffling his deck. But he has one manual attachment for sure. Most likely going to attach it to the Yveltal and the Float Stone to the active Jirachi. And with that, Professor Sycamore, he would love to find a Fighting Fury Belt.
Yeah, Fighting Fury Belt would be pretty huge here. Also, simply just finding other Pokemon. Potentially doesn't even want to put them down this turn, but for future turns, that's going to be important, because although 40 is a pretty big number right now, it's not going to be great later on. Tord does have to worry about, he doesn't have any other energy in his hand, so simply promoting the Yveltal only doing 30 doesn't seem ideal. I think there is still one more Trainer's Mail in his hand, which he could potentially scout things with, but this is an interesting one here for sure. Looks like he's eyeing up, potentially that's an Ultra Ball that we're seeing here. he's kind of grimacing about it. First off, we are going to see a Trainer's Mail before anything else.
Well, there's a Max Elixir, but now that he... Not really sure if it's going to do him any good at this point. Still going for it.
Yeah, I believe he does have a Yveltal EX in his hand, so he should be able to get some value from this Max Elixir. Didn't really need the VS Seeker because I believe there's already one in there, so he's likely going to be looking to Sycamore later down the line. So no reason to really pick up the VS Seeker if it's only going to punish you later on. Looks like he does have a few things, but obviously there's no point to put a target on the board if it can simply be Lysandered, so comfortable to just hold the hand for now.
Exactly, and here's the Crushing Hammer. Not very surprising, four copies in the deck. There's the first heads. But now we're actually facing a very similar situation than before. Oblivion Wing Yveltal is here, and it's going to be able to recover that darkness energy, and at some point there's going to be an Yveltal EX that is going to hit for lots of damage.
Yeah, that is definitely the case. Martin gets a big pickup here with the Ultra Ball, so he's going to be able to protect his Rattata. The 30 HP, I mean the 10 HP remaining is a big deal here because it's going to be a threat later on in the game, and now he can simply pay retreat from that Rattata, and he can find himself probably a Houndoom and start putting pressure once again on the deck size that Tord has here. He's got a pretty awkward Ultra Ball. Looks like he's happy to get rid of Max Potion, and he's also looking to get rid of the N here.
He has a Versus Seeker in hand, so at any point he can still recover that N if he wants to. Houndoom EX is coming. Let's first of all have a look at all the resources that he needs to keep track of. Now Houndoom priced, no Raticate priced, so that's all good for him.
Yeah, it looks all pretty good. He's going to have another option to use setup. Not really sure what else he needs too much. He's actually going to opt to go for the Bunnelby here, which is interesting. He might want to recycle some of his own cards, because oftentimes getting multiple Crushing Hammers simply back in your deck is going to be important. So that's an interesting call from Martin here. He feels safe enough that the Bunnelby can survive attacks from the Oblivion Wing. He's not under threat from the EX, so you may as well try and force your opponent into taking more non-EX knockouts.
And now he might be considering using... Oh, he's using setup instead of the N with the Versus Seeker. With the N, he could have disrupted Tord's plan to benching the Yveltal EX next turn. And here's the Fighting Fury Belt. He was looking for that because now it can take four attacks from the Oblivion Wing Yveltal, which might be coming in very handy.
He's just picked up the Delinquent as well. That's kind of the reason why he was asking Tord about his hand size. And he is then going to VS Seeker and play the N. A much nicer setup from Martin's side of the board. Last game, he was sort of scrambling with only one Houndoom at a time. Here, he can retreat the Rattata this turn, start going for either attack from Bunnelby. Of course, it has the Theta double trait, so it's able to attack twice during one turn, which is going to be absolutely brilliant. Both attacks really help out Martin's approach. He can either recover cards from his own discard pile, lots of awkward things, lots of VS Seekers, more Crushing Hammers he can get back, or he can just simply choose to start trying to mill Tord as best as possible.
Yeah, and Tord now is wondering, would I have been better off benching that Yveltal EX and using my Max Elixir? Immediately we'll have the answer very soon. Yveltal EX being in his hand, also basic energy, that's all he needs for now.
Yeah, absolutely, and it looks like Martin did pick up an Ultra Ball. That's going to be interesting. Maybe getting Houndooms later down the line. For now, though, he's happy enough simply to retreat back into that Bunnelby. Here comes the Ultra Ball. Okay, so he does have more Fire Energy in Team Flare Grunt. He does have the VS Seeker to fall back on, and he plays a full four count of Team Flare Grunt, so it seems pretty okay to go for this approach. He's just going to grab himself a Houndoom for future turns, and he's also going to check out. Looks like he's checking his own discard pile. I think he's going to want to put a few things back himself. He's going to grab the VS Seeker and the Crushing Hammer, shuffle those back in, thanks to the Rototiller attack from Bunnelby that you can see there.
Yeah, right now he's not under pressure from Tord's side. No Yveltal EX inside. We know that there's one coming very shortly. But at the same time, Martin can take this time to make sure that my deck is filled up with cards that are going to be able to help me manage Tord's resources better than I did last time, so that he's able to discard all the energy that Tord is going to recover during the next turns.
And this is a war where really both people are checking their discard piles furiously. It's a resource management war for both players, and you can see Tord considering all of his options, looking at what's already in there, and then similarly he's going to have a look at what Martin has in his own discard pile. Putting the Fighting Fury Belt on the Bunnelby is a subtle play, but I do really like it. It's really forcing Tord to make an action. He has to start putting down the Yveltal EX. He has to start trying to get that set up, and that is what we're going to see. We're going to see the bench of the Yveltal EX alongside an attachment for turn onto the XY Yveltal in the active position, and he might be content to Oblivion Wing here, but at the same time, the Bunnelby and the Houndoom, they start putting on pressure very early on, so players have the option. They can be patient and potentially lose valuable resources from their deck, or they can try to be proactive. They know they're losing cards from their hand,
but then potentially they can more aggressively deal with the Bunnelby and the Houndoom that's in front of them.
There's also a very interesting decision on Todd's side. There was a Floatstone in his hand, but he decided not to attach it. There are reasons he could attach it to the basic Yveltal EX in the active spot, so that he could later on free retreat into Yveltal EX and start Evilballing away. But at the same time, he might have to keep it, because there might always be the threat of a Lysander coming from Martin and having the Yveltal EX in the active spot stuck without having Oblivion Wing available to him. So he decided, I'm going to keep it, but at the same time, and made sure that the Floatstone is going back into the deck. So it's always a very tough decision for Todd when to use a resource, and always running into the risk of having a Burrow attack or maybe Houndoom EX discarding it while it's in the deck.
Absolutely. So back over to Martin's turn, we are going to see the attachment of Fire Energy onto that Houndoom as well. We are going to see the VS Seeker finding that end so he can refresh his hand. He's found himself a Crushing Hammer, and that's going to get flipped right now. It gets heads. Naturally, he's going to do it on the active Pokemon. Otherwise, he could. Tord was able to simply Oblivion Wing again. This way, it forces Tord to actually have a Dark Energy in hand, which we can see he has been fortunate enough to get. And again, we are going to see the Rototiller from the Bunnelby. Martin saying that, you know what, I want my own resources back more. These are the things that are more important than starting to mill your deck right now.
Yeah, and we can see that Todd has, again, energy available to him. He has Max Elixir. Everything he was looking for right now to make sure that Martin's turn is negated, that the Crushing Hammer heads is negated. Attaching to the active spot, most likely. Interesting to see if he's going for Max Elixir. At this point, his deck is full of resources, so might as well go for it.
Yeah, I think it's still definitely worth it. Right now, you can assume that you're going to go through this Bunnelby in a few attacks, but you still need to get that big Yveltal EX. That was his win condition last game. It's going to be the same approach this game. Doesn't quite hit it, but it's still going to be his approach. He's still going to try and get this Yveltal EX as powered up as possible.
Yeah, it looks similar than last game, but for sure we can see that Tortoise is taking much longer to power up his Yveltal EX, and this is exactly what Martin needs. He's not going into the offensive this time, so he's managing his own resources on Martin's side. And maybe this is paying off for him, because Tortoise is really struggling right now. He's managing his energy, he's trying to keep them in play, but at the same time he's not dishing out any damage, or not much damage right now. He's only trying to get this Bunnelby off the field, but we're fighting Fury, but it's going to take two more turns at least to get rid of it.
Yeah, and it's kind of awkward that 100 HP from Bunnelby is so useful, because it could tempt Tord into putting a Fighting Fury Belt down on one of these turns. If it does do that, then from then on in the game, that Yveltal becomes a Lysander target. So you really have to play carefully. There are times when you think, oh great, this number works out perfectly, I can KO the Bunnelby next turn, but it could lead to awkward turns down the line. So for now, we just see Tord go for the 30 damage Oblivion Wing, and it's going to pass back over to Martin, who does have a Trainer's Mail, and he's mulling over what's in there. I think he's found himself a Super Rod, and I'm not sure if he wants to take it. He could potentially also go for just an N. There's no real harm in putting N in your hand, but he could be considering that I want to recycle some energies, or even some the Bunnelby that started to get damaged, so may as well pick that in the hand, which pretty much indicates to me that he already has a lot of VS Seekers, and straight away that's exactly what we see. He has a stacked hand full of VS Seekers, so Martin's going to have a few turns to sit on this hand where he can simply VS Seeker away, start using things like that Team Flare Grunt, and I think there was also maybe even a Delinquent in his hand, so Martin's going to be sat on this for a while until he exhausts all the resources in his hand, and then he's going to play the end once he's finished doing all of those things.
The Delinquent could be very, very interesting for Martin in this case, because if he catches Tord with a hand size 3 or smaller, this is going to put him into top deck mode. And at the same time, if Martin can play a Delinquent and a Crushing Hammer in the same turn, discarding all the energy from the Oblivion Wing Yveltal, this is going to be bad times for Tord.
Absolutely. So Tord is just going to finish shuffling up Martin's deck after once again he opted to Rototiller with Bunnelby rather than burrowing. And it comes back over to Tord, who has an awkward turn himself here. The only manual attachment that he has potential to do right now is double colorless energy. We can see that Martin is threatening the Raticate on the bench already. No specials in the discard just yet for Tord, but this could be the first one of many.
And he is attaching it to the benched Yveltal, actually, so maybe going for an N or a Professor Sycamore to try and find that Floatstone. If he can't, this is going to be a little bit of a wasted turn for him. So six cards for him to find that Floatstone. One of them is gone. He has two left.
Yeah, absolutely. This is a big N from Tord. Seeing Martin casually go for the VS Seeker for the Team Flare Grunt rather than trying to recycle his hand with something like N probably indicated that he had quite a strong hand. and he needed Floatstone this turn so that he's able to deal with the Bunnelby now and get value from this double colors energy early on. Again, he has the option to go for Y Cyclone. I think this time it's a little bit more tempting because, again, there's no Floatstone just yet, so who knows what he's going to find, but putting more energy around your board is sometimes tempting. At the same time, it was the big old Yveltal EX that simply won him the game because it was able to take one hit KOs, so looks like it was a big whiff from Tord there.
Ooh. It is. The only option would have been to bench Shaman for one energy, but here we go, enhanced him, and now it's Martinsson. This is the turn he has been looking for. This was a little bit of a slip up for Tord, and here we go, crushing Hammer. He's trying to control this board right now.
That was absolutely instant from Martin. As soon as it passed over to his turn, he draws for turn, he goes for the enhanced Hammer, follows up with the crushing Hammer, it gets heads, and it's really set Tord back here quite a bit.
And the judge is trying to figure out something which was going on. It was a crushing Hammer heads. Darkness energy gets discarded. And now I wouldn't be surprised to see if Martin would go for the Burrow for the very first time and go for the opponent's deck.
Yeah, his hand looks very strong. At the same time, why not just keep recycling these crushing Hammers? The one thing that this deck needs to do is just keep finding them because they're very useful. Obviously, we see when they hit heads, they have such a big impact. You could even see him use one attack into the other. There's a lot of options for him here. He's looking to use VS Seeker. Looks like he's going to be playing N here to shuffle and draw in a fresh hand himself.
But didn't he play the Team Flare Grunt? Or
no, it was an Enhanced Hammer and the Crushing so far. It was Tord who missed on the Floatstone last turn.
So Tord didn't attach to the Oblivion Wing Yveltal.
No, he chose the double colors energy and instantly got punished for that decision.
That's right.
Martin, not too much else he needs this turn. He's just going to play the end to again try and refresh. No reason not to. He can carry on with the Bunnelby. Surprised he actually kind of went for the end because Tord was missing out on the Floatstone. So, again, it was a judgment call from him. And he looks again to be recycling the same two cards over and over again, VS Seeker and Crushing Hammer. This means that even when he's getting hit with ends, he's going to have these options throughout the game.
That's a very, very interesting strategy. We can see that Tord now has access to the Floatstone. Actually, I think I also saw a Darkness Energy in his hand, so Tord can go back to using Oblivion Wing if he wants to. Or the other option would have been to attach the Floatstone to the active Yveltal and then start evil balling away, but I would think he's going with the Oblivion Wing for now.
Yeah, it's an interesting call. If he goes for the Floatstone and starts attacking with the EX, then that pretty much needs a Floatstone because it can start getting hit with Team Flare Grunt and this, that, and the other. So very, very awkward stuff. I could quite easily see just an Oblivion Wing here to be a little bit slower because he wants to build the Yveltal EX up to a point where it can start dealing with everything on Martin's side of the board, not just the Bunnelby this turn.
The advantage for Martin just naturally is he's playing this deck over and over and over again. He knows exactly what he needs to do to beat an Yveltal EX deck. On the other hand, Tord is seeing maybe one or two copies at best throughout the day, and maybe even through deck testing. This is not going to be a top priority to deck test against, so he has to think about what he's going to do in this particular match every single time again and again, because those situations just don't come up that often.
Absolutely, and it's not a fun deck to play against. Maybe you play one game against this and you think, oh, this is a really lame deck. Why am I wasting my time playing against this thing? But Martin, he's found a way that people don't like playing against this deck, so why don't I play it myself and make life awkward for my opponents? We see the Lysander trying to make it so that Martin can't continue to reuse that Bunnelby. Additionally, it means the Shaman EX is now active, so potentially he can finish the game a little bit quicker as long as it stays in the active position, just by going through 3EX Pokemon.
Hey, he caught Martin there in an awkward spot because another heads and the crowd goes wild. There's an awkward spot for Martin now because he doesn't have an energy. He would need to retreat with the Shaman EX. Maybe he is forced to play an N now. He has a max potion. Yeah, there's the N.
Yeah, he's going to go for the N. We know he's looking for the fire energy. I think there are a handful in his discard pile. So far, he's not been tempted to use Bunnelby to recycle any of them. There's also the Super on in his discard pile, which he's refused to get back. So maybe a little bit on the back foot here with that N. Tord finding his out so far, and he's still doing okay. He still has quite a sizable deck. You can see him shuffling it right now. Not too much danger for him, seeing as though Martin's been continuing to recycle his own deck rather than Tord so far.
You also have to watch the clock right now, so only 12 minutes left on the clock for Martin. to try and equal out this match. It's going to be very tough to win it all for him at this point. And Tord knows this, of course, and he's going to take his time here maybe to make a decision. He has to anyway because he's not used to them. And Martin actually misses out on the energy. That is huge.
Yeah, it's a bit of a misstep here because I think Martin, at this point, he might still start going aggressive. This would have been probably a turn where he starts going for the discards because he didn't have anything else to really Crushing Hammer or anything like that. So there weren't any resources in his discard that he wanted, so he may as well start going for Tords. Unfortunately, missing out on that because of the missed fire energy. And back over to Tord now. He's able to max Elixir to that Yveltal EX, and it's starting to get sizable, which is pretty good stuff here. I think he has a manual attachment for turn. It might still be, once again, the Oblivion Wing. It's putting in so much work for Tord here.
And Tord taking his time here now, of course, thinking about the max elixir. Where should I attach it? Jirachi or Yveltal EX?
It's always a tough decision.
Yeah, it's tough, man. It's tough. Tough times.
So Tord is going to debate this darkness energy. It is going to eventually go onto the active, and we are going to see the Oblivion Wing most likely after a bit of debate from Tord here. There's nothing wrong with taking your time over decisions. It's a lively pace of play is the only real description for how long it should take to make decisions. But towards one game up, we've seen that every little bit of second is an advantage for him right now.
Absolutely, and he's going for exactly that. So Martin trying to discard the energy again, Team Flare grunt, but at the same time, does he have something to move that Shaman out of the active spot? And the answer is no, pass.
Yep, we do see just a pass from him. There is a Floatstone in Tord's hand. I would quite like to see this go onto the non-EX Yveltal, and maybe he could start pressuring now, taking prizes of his own. Again, you can see he's debating things, what he wants to do. Fortunately for him, both of those Rattatas have become Raticates already, so he doesn't have to worry about getting his tools taken off the board. So those Floatstones are pretty much here to stay now, as long as he can get them on. So that's exactly what we're going to see from Tord here. Floatstone does go onto the active. We also see the break evolution. I think he's trying to protect himself from things like N in future turns because he wants to pretty much be able to storm through everything. I think it's a good turn for him to bring in the Yveltal EX because he'll be taking two prizes here, and it's such a big deal.
And the only option for Tord would have been to play the Professor Sycamore, and he's doing it anyway just to find a darkness energy to keep attacking with Oblivion Ring because he wouldn't have any basic energy. Let's see if he can find it right now, and if so, where he would attach it.
Again, it's one of these reactive things. He saw Martin have a fairly weak turn, simply Team Flare grunt and pass. So he wants to go on the aggressive like he did last game. He was always in a comfortable range with his own deck size because that Yveltal EX was simply too powered up and there was no other Lysander targets as there are right now. So I think this is the time to move in if you're Tord here.
Yeah, at this point, he has two double colorless energy available to him. He's benching a Shame, which is interesting. I think he has the option of course, also Sky returning here. That's an interesting one. As long as Martin can't move, might as well go for it.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, there's no real reason not to, other than just stalling for turns. I think Tord is aware of the clock. Everything's on his side, so making the turns go long is another win condition for him. So it seems absolutely fine to me.
There's a fire energy, I believe, now in Martin's hand. So he's finally going to be able to move that Shaman. Here we go. Let's see if it's going to be Bunnelby or Houndoom.
Yeah, it looks like it's just purely because the amount of energy that Yveltal EX has. You can see Martin doing the maths in his head. It might well just be the Bunnelby. It's a non-EX. There's also a max potion in Martin's hands that he's trying to figure out if he can get usage out of it. That Yveltal EX is looking pretty intimidating.
This point, it's 130 damage if he uses Houndoom, so double colorless energy would be enough, and he fears that because he hasn't seen any of these, the chances are rather high that he finds something eventually. So he's going with the Bunnelby and says, it doesn't matter, if either Pokemon is going down, I want Bunnelby to go down.
Absolutely, that's the threat right now. He's going to pay retreat on that Shaman EX. In comes the Bunnelby. He does have some Crushing Hammers, which he can start trying to use as well, so that could help him in his mission to stay healthy with his Bunnelby and keep using those attacks once again. So Martin is going to continue to look through his own discard pile. He might once again be choosing to recycle his own side of the discard rather than Tord's here. It's been interesting to see this deck in action. I would have thought he would have oftentimes been much more aggressive on the opponent, But Martin has played it very differently. He's been using Rototiller almost exclusively this game.
And very interesting, he did not play that Crushing Hammer immediately, decided against it. And now Tord, we know he doesn't have a Darkness Energy in hand, he only has double colorless. It's very interesting to see now where he's going to attach it. Is he going to continue with Sky Return? It's not going to be enough to pick out the KO on Bunnelby, so he might decide against it. Maybe he's going for the Evil Ball or maybe Y Cyclone for the very first time. Very interesting to see what he's going to do now.
Yeah, well, it's all really in Tord's opinion, what he thinks is best. If he's not too worried about the Bunnelby, he can simply just go for a Sky Return play, protect those double colorless energies. Alternatively, he could simply just retreat and attack without attaching anything. There's a few options for him here. It depends how aggressive he really wants to go. Now that he is a non-EX, it feels a lot less appealing to simply take it out of the game, other than the fact that the Bunnelby is annoying because it keeps getting that Rototiller going.
Tord has so many cards in hand, of course, many options available to him. Does he really want to use them, though? So here's another Shaman. It looks like he's going for another Sky Return. He thinks that the time is working against Martin, and he's right with that. So as long as there's no real pressure on his deck size, his deck is still very sizable, he might think, I can take 1 minute per turn, and that should be enough for me to close out this match in 1-0 fashion.
And I think the reason he's going for this Sky Return play is really because he knows Martin plays a full complement of 14 Flare Grunts. There's no real point in bringing in the Yveltal EX just to take one prize to then start getting hit with Team Flare Grunt, then you're out of range with the Houndoom. Here he's going slowly on the Bunnelby, so eventually he can bring up the Yveltal EX and start taking prizes. But here, there's something else that Martin plays that can punish these sorts of slow plays. It's going to be the Max Potion, fully healing three attacks off that Bunnelby, and then starting now, finally, we're seeing the Burrow.
The Burrow is here. We have confirmation. Now Tord, taking his time, is this my Yveltal break? Yes, it is. It has a Floatzone attached to it. Yeah. So am I going to bench this Shaman? Not sure about this. Here we go. That's a Darkness Energy. That's interesting. So he can continue with Oblivion Wing for now.
Yeah, exactly. He's going for the Oblivion Wing. Not sure how many Dark are remaining in his discard pile. I think there's still one or two. So he's still content to go on to the Bunnelby, unless he's going to be going for potentially a Lysander play. Not too sure what Tord wants to do here. He seems to be content enough to play into Martin's Max Potions. He's just seen it. The Bunnelby has taken a lot of hits, and then it simply Max Potioned it all off. Tord still allowing this to be the case, so it's interesting to see what he's got here. And really, it's down to Tord to see what he wants to do. He's taken a long time for this decision, but eventually he is eyeing up that Lysander, and I'm not sure what he's trying to take out here, because again, it could be that option where he wants to deal with EX Pokemon exclusively. Alternatively, he could be bringing something into the active position simply to force Martin to have another energy, so he's under less pressure from all of these Burrows and Rototillers. So I think this is a play where not necessarily he wants to deal with the Shaman quickly, he simply wants to keep it in the active, forcing more answers out of Martin.
Now it's Martin's turn, let's see if he has another energy available to him, and he does, using it for the retreat, going for the Bunnelby again. Most likely going with the Burrow, here we go, 10 seconds per turn, two cards discarded on Tord's side, and Tord is, Tord's turn again.
Yeah, back over to Tord. He's just taking his time. He's keeping those double color synergies safely in his hand because, of course, the Raticate would always be a threat otherwise. All of those enhanced hammers that Martin plays, you don't want to play into those sorts of things with the Evil Balls, so you may as well keep them safe in the hand so that they're not in the deck or in the the field, because that's the only place Martin can't access it currently. So finally, we are going to see the Yveltal EX come into the active position, and Tord now feels like there's enough Dark Energy on this Yveltal EX where it's the right time to start taking prizes for the first time in this game too.
Yeah, the Fighting Fury Belt is not going to do the Bunnelby any good. It's going down. We don't need to do the math here. It's gone. We have 5 energy attached to the Yveltal, 1 to the Houndoom, so that's 150 damage with the Fighting Fury Belt. If Tord was able to find, now it's double colorless that he needs for the Yveltal. No, nope. Now it's a little bit too much that he needs, so Houndoom is here to stay most likely.
That's
next turn.
Pretty big for Martin. He gets the heads flip on the Crushing Hammer, and then we see the Team Flare Grunt putting down, basically hurting Tord by 40 damage, making it a lot less effective. So this aggressive Yveltal EX approach that we've all been hyping up really for the whole game, that how aggressive it can be, Martin straight away takes it down a peg or two.
Yeah, and the Versus Seeker discard is very important, because Tord at when the game comes to an end, is going to rely on N to try and shuffle his big hand back into the deck. Depending on how many price cards he will have taken, he is going to go down to one hand for one card in hand, and his deck is going to be much bigger than his hand. So using his Versus Seeker is going to be a very important part of his game. He's using another one.
I think once again it might be the Lysander that he looks to use here. He could... Oh, in fact, he's going to go for the N instead, potentially here. It's a couple of decisions, really. He could start just trying to go for the two-hit KO on the Houndoom. That's always an option. Martin does obviously have the max potions available. He's taking every moment here to check Martin's deck and discard and all his card hands and everything like that. It's important to discuss these things and think about them all. And then we are finally going to see just the evil ball here.
Yeah, and he's not going for the N, he's just retrieving it with the Versus Seeker in this case. So he's preparing for an N coming from Martin potentially, and then these cards could be discarded immediately while they are in the deck. And here he's just benching another Houndoom, also thinking about what to do. There's another Team Flagrant, though the energy on Tor's side is disappearing, one more from the deck.
Absolutely, wow. One more energy gone from Tor. He does still have enough, fortunately, for him to finish off this Houndoom EX, so he'll be taking more prizes if need be. Again, he can go for a slower approach, but I think he's starting to run out of deck. We're going to see Martin now count how many left. I believe that's 6 or 7, so he is getting pretty close. Tor does have the double colors energy, which now is going to be attached. So finally, we're going to see this Yveltal EX. He's sort of setting himself up. We know he has enough damage to KO right now, but he's anticipating the other Houndoom to come into the active at some point, which immediately we see. So he's trying to mitigate the incoming Crushing Hammers. And again, that's one that we see straight away. It does get a tails flip there, though.
Yeah, it's now, it really comes down to, is Martin able to discard enough darkness energy on Tor's side? He's going to be able to stand one of the Evil Ball attacks for sure next turn, most likely. But at the same time, there's only 35 seconds left on the clock, and it's not going to be enough for him to discard 6 cards in Tor's deck.
Absolutely. So, Martin now, he's just going to play the Professor Sycamore as quickly as possible. The time is against him, and he's going to quickly draw those 7. He's going to instantly attach a Fire Energy, and it might be the only action he has left to do. It's going to be taking 2 cards out of Tord's deck, including one of them being an N, which could potentially be big here.
That is indeed big, but I think Tord still has one in hand.
And Tord taking his time with his Evil Ball math.
So we have 6, so that's 150 damage. One more energy would seal the deal on the active Houndoom in this case, and that's more than enough.
Absolutely.
So Houndoom is going to go down. Tord down to 1 prize card then.
Yep, exactly. Tord is also considering what other options he needs to think about, and he is going to go for the N now. You can see on Martin's face, he's not too happy about this.
Probably time has just been called, and I think he realized I was so close, and now with time being called and the N, that's pretty much sealing the deal for him.
I'm pretty sure that could be everything now. Tord, of course, the one game up, and I think he's out of range in terms of how thick his deck size is. He's played this very well, played only the cards he's absolutely had to, and once again it's come down to having that one card in his deck. The one non-EX Yveltal has been able to circulate the amount of dark energies. Martin has taken a crazy amount of energies off this board, but simply Tord has responded by putting it straight back on.
You just gotta love the way that Tord is maneuvering this Yveltal EX deck. It's just fantastic to look at it. Martin throwing everything he's got against Tord, but he realizes nothing that he could do extends the hand. He sighs, he knows there was a big opportunity that he would win this if he had more time, but no, Tord taking down the whole match in a 1-0 fashion. Congratulations.
Yeah, that was a pretty close game. I think normally Martin can prey on decks like Yveltal EX because that XY introduction that Tord has gone for over something like Super Odd, which is sometimes more common, has really paid off for him here. And he just happened to face one of the few Yveltal players who had it. And that's going to be a huge sigh of release for Tord, because that's a deck that you don't often play against every day. And it's one that you really have to be careful of at every point in the game, because there are so many cards that can be punishing. There's Delinquent you have to be on the lookout for, there's Lysander for stall, there's the Rattatas which can get rid of tools, there's all sorts of different things. The full deck is equipped to try and stop your opponent playing, so trying to play as few cards as possible whilst also protecting yourself as much as possible is a very delicate sort of line to balance across.
I agree, and I think we just saw Martin looking a little bit disappointed with himself, maybe with his deck, but I think he shouldn't be. It was a great fight that he put up here, and he was very, very close to getting to a draw against Tord, but well, at the end it really was Oblivion Wing Yveltal that made the difference here in this matchup.
Absolutely, that was the case. So we'll be right back shortly for an interview, but before that we're just going to talk a little bit more about this list. I mean, it's one of these things that comes around every now and again. The mill approach is just such a different approach to any other deck. We saw that eventually it didn't have enough firepower, but so many other decks have fallen prey to Martin's list so far. It's just a huge amount of the crushing and enhanced hammers, not many need for anything like Trainer's Mail. He's simply saying, every turn I want to be using an annoying supporter card, and we have a plethora available to us, so that's the approach that we've gone for here.
You know, if you realize that you're up against a mill deck, especially on Pokémon Trading Card Game Online, there are two opinions. One is, I feel disgusted, maybe I'm even giving up right away because I just don't want to deal with it. And the other one, I'm saying, this is going to be interesting because it's going to be a matchup like none other. And I think Tord had to, well, he just can't give up and he can't concede immediately, but I think he's done so very well. I think he's very well prepared against these kind of decks, and maybe he's realized that Yveltal might have a very sore spot here against those mill decks, and he put this Oblivion Wing Yveltal in for a very specific reason. And if we're going to get a chance in the winner's interview, we're going to ask him just for that.
Yeah, I'm certain that the answer would not be for Houndoom Bunnelby. However, it could be for other sorts of enhanced hammer and heavy hammered build decks. So it's going to be interesting to hear what he has to say. So we're going to pass it over to Ryan, who is going to be with Tord for the interview.
Hello everyone, I'm here with Tord, who was victorious over Martin just now. And I just wanted to ask you a few questions. First of all, congratulations for that victory, 2-0, very, very impressive. Did you actually have an idea of what kind of deck Martin had before the match?
I had heard rumors about that he played a mill deck with Raticate and Bunnelby and Houndoom. So I knew that I couldn't bench anything. I had to just charge up one big guy and go all in on that one.
Oh, I see, yeah. Because I was going to ask you, what was the reasoning behind the Obliviator Wing Yveltal card?
The reason for playing Oblivion Wing?
Yeah, the reason for having that up front.
So I could recycle on all my energies the whole game, because his strategy was to discard them all. But as long as that one was active, I could always recycle them and put them on the bench and pose a threat.
Oh, that's really interesting. Okay. And another question, yeah, so regarding Yveltal, I mean, obviously there are a lot of variations of the Yveltal deck. What would you say makes yours special and why?
I don't know. I just try to go for a consistent list and just play my best and hope for the best.
All right, brilliant. And who is the MVP, most valuable Pokémon in your deck?
Yveltal EX, without a doubt.
All right there. Well, that's great stuff. And are you feeling confident for the rest of the event?
I think I only have to get one more point to make top 8, but I don't know. So I hope I can make it. All depends on the last round.
All right, humble words. And how are you feeling about the TCG 17 format?
The TCG 7 format?
TCG 17 format? Or did I get something wrong? Or maybe I meant something. Okay, forget that question. Well, in any case, thank you very much. And we're going to go back to the casters now. Take it away.
Welcome back, everyone. So we realized now Tord was very much into bringing his Oblivion Wing Yveltal, no matter if it was Houndoom, if it was Bunnelby. He thought this is just the most consistent way of approaching this current meta game. And because we've seen Tord's decklist on stream before, we think it's time to show you the Houndoom. We have the decklist prepared. Houndoom, Bunnelby, Raticate. Here it is, Pokémon Trading Card Game Online. We would like to discuss the decklist with you right now.
Yeah, I'm certain we're going to have a whole load of questions, and a lot of people are going to be probably even screenshotting the list that's going to be right in front of you, because it is definitely an interesting one. Some of the counts in here, I had to look twice at some of these, because very interesting decisions throughout. Starting off with the Pokémon, the main attacker is going to be the Houndoom EX. Now, it's not an attacker that you use for damage, of course, we were seeing throughout the game. It's all about the Melting Horn, the first attack for a single fire energy, discarding the top two cards of your opponent's deck. It's a very simple approach, but sometimes very, very effective.
It is very simple, and there's another Pokémon besides Houndoom EX that can exactly do the same, but just with less HP. So Houndoom packs 170 HP. We've never seen a Pokémon that was able to mill effectively two cards per turn that has that many HP. So this is what Houndoom does best. Immediately, especially against Yveltal EX, if you have Crushing Hammers, you can make sure that the Evil Ball is not hitting you for so much damage, so you can at least get two or three Melting Horns in. And if you think you don't need a Pokémon EX to attack with, well, there's this Bunnelby that is very, very flexible to work with.
And flexible is definitely the word here. Thanks to his Omega Barrage trait, he's able to attack twice. That means that he's not locked into the same attack both times. He could choose to use Burrow, the first attack, for a colorless energy, discarding the top card of your opponent's deck. You could opt to use that twice, or you could opt to use once and then go on to the Rototiller, which is also for a colorless energy, very efficient. You're able to shuffle a card from your discard pile back into your own deck. Alternatively, of course, you could shuffle two cards back into your own deck. We saw that often be the case for Martin. He wanted to continue to get VS Seeker back into his deck because it helps him continually get things like the guaranteed energy discard with Team Flare Grunt, or just recycle his hand with things like N or Professor Sycamore. Additionally, he can get back other things like Crushing Hammer, which is always going to be a threat here.
Yeah, you were talking about flexibility, and talking about flexibility, this deck is of course meant to try and discard as many cards from your opponent's deck as possible. But if that doesn't work out, or if your opponent invests in too many energy or in just one Pokémon with all the energy he has, there's something to retaliate with.
Absolutely. It's rare to see a mill deck actually have some firepower waiting in the back, but it's one of the ways that makes it even more awkward to play around. Raticate fits the theme of the deck perfectly. Again, it has just two single energy attack costs, the first of them being Crunch. The 10 damage isn't going to threaten too much, but a discard, a guaranteed discard in fact, of an energy attached to your opponent's active is very, very strong. As we saw, sometimes players will only have one Pokemon ready to go. They're going to try and power it up. Every single turn of the game, Raticate is going to guarantee a discard from there. Following on from that, we have the Shadowy Bite. We do 60 times the number of special energy cards in your opponent's discard pile. Plenty of decks out there right now are playing special energy, and being able to access the hand with a Delinquent, the deck with all the mill cards like the Houndoom, and simply forcing your opponent to attach these energy to attack with in the first place, and then using things like Hammers and even the Team Flare Grunt, this attack can get very powerful, and you can simply wipe out the attacker that they were charging up the whole game.
Yeah, every card, almost every attack is meant to troll your opponent, and there's one Pokemon that is trolling as well. It's Rattata. With all those players out there, and I know you too, we're looking for something that is able to discard items out there. We have Rattata with the ability of discarding a tool attached to the opposing active Pokemon. And so both Raticate with the discard ability and Rattata with discarding Pokemon tools, you can try and have a Pokemon be stuck in the active spot with Trubbish, for example, Lysand, and then Rattata in this case for Trubbish. Or if you have an Yveltal with Oblivion Wing, you could use Raticate to try and discard the energy that is attached to it and hope that your opponent can't follow up with another darkness energy. Everything is meant to try and have your opponent be stuck in the current situation, or force him into an awkward Professor Sycamore where he has to invest more resources and trying to get his prize cards.
Yeah, absolutely. And you think about other decks out there in the format. There's something like Volcanion, which has, just like the non-EX Yveltal, but it always plays the non-EX Volcanion, which has amazing energy acceleration from the discard pile. Your only real win condition is going to be prey on the float stones, use this Rattata, the mischievous fang, to try and catch one of their big EXs that's chilling on the bench with a float stone. I feel like that's the only win condition this deck has, and it's all thanks to this little 40 HP Rattata.
Yeah, we have to say, I mean, it has been working out for Martin quite well. He has so many wins, not so many draws, or not any draw at all, and he has made it into day two. So for him to advance to the next day is going to be a little bit of a struggle because he has quite a few losses, but just getting here is a big accomplishment, and a big accomplishment for his deck also.
Yeah, a huge accomplishment for the deck, and he seems to be one of the few players piloting it, and over this tournament he's made top 32. Into the second day, and the same thing happened in Dortmund where he was able to do the same thing. So clearly he is experienced with the deck, and he's found a way to make it work for him a lot of the time. And even though now it's no longer a secret, many of the European players, their heads were turning when they found out that Martin Janouš, the legendary Martin Janouš, was playing a deck like this. Obviously people are already asking questions about the list. Well, here we go, there's the answer. A huge amount of crushing and enhanced hammers, 4 max potion as well, so if ever people are able to get enough energy to attack, or if they have very efficient single attachment attacks, as long as it's not getting the one hit KO, 170 HP is difficult, even 2 Fighting Fury Bell in the list as well, to make it even more difficult, 210 HP is a huge amount to get in one hit knockout, so those 4 max potions can oftentimes set the opponent back a turn, so many reasons why it's awkward at every single step of the way. for the opponent to do anything against this deck.
Yeah, there are two opinions for this deck, not much in between. You either hate it or you just love it. I personally love it. I also love watching it. I'm not sure if we're going to see a deck like this again in day two or maybe even in the top eight, but I hope you enjoyed this little round. It wasn't able to pull off the victory, but I hope for him that he's going to have some better matchups coming up very soon. For this round, we're wrapping it up, but we're going to be back very soon with the next round of Swiss.